day for work here at the Happy Healthy Workplace podcast. I'm Kimberly Ficklin, your host. And every week we talk to professionals just like you all around the world.
Today we're talking to Sarah
Goodall. We want to find out what they do
to
create a profitable business. The kind of business
Tribal
people really want
to empower your workforce and wider ecosystem to become digital ambassadors for your brand. They help you positively impact lead generation, referral recruitment, revenue growth, and employee engagement. Now, they say no one can tell your brand story better than those who live it every day, your employees. When employee expertise and talents are showcased in front of the logo, they bring a whole new level of authenticity, credibility, and trust to your brand story. Now, they have two quotes here on their website that I thought was really interesting. One says, employees have, on average, 10 times more followers than corporate social accounts. And the other one is that while only 2% of employees reshare the content their company share, they're responsible for 20% of the overall engagement, you know, like views, likes, comments, and shares that content receives. And I think that's pretty significant. That's sourced from LinkedIn for everybody to know, because if you make your employees happy, they tell everybody about it and they tell it on your social media. And then the other thing that's really fun before we get into this with Sarah is that she talks about the F words. And I think that's fun. We'll have to ask her more about what that's all about. But a few of these F words are fun, flexible, fearless, feedback, and focus. And if you listen to the last podcast, number 10, with Karen Rayburn, you'll know that she also had these pillar type things in her business. And that's basically what this is with Sarah, but she's created something really fun called the F word. Today, though, what we're going to talk about is something that everybody really wants to know. We have this conversation a lot on this podcast, which is how to work remotely with autonomy. How do you create community in an off-premise workforce? Sarah, you're going to give us some great information today. I just know it. But let's start with, why was this so important in your business? Why did you see the need to work remotely in your business? Let's just start with that.
Yeah, well, it's an interesting one. Do you know what? I've always worked in a remote role for over 20 years. I remember my first job with IBM, actually, and I was working with a guy who was up in Scotland, and if for one reason or another, he couldn't travel. So we were one of the first adopters of one of these chat tools, even over 20 years ago when, you know, email was just coming in, if you like. So for me, though, when I set up Tribal, I realized that I'm kind of quite used to that. And everybody was asking me, when are you going to set your office up? When are you going to get an office? And there were several reasons. And I just thought, well, really, that is quite expensive, having an office. For two, I'm comfortable working in virtual roles. I've always done that. I've always worked in global teams, virtual working, you know, and the technology is there where you really should be able to do that. And then thirdly, I thought, well, the moment you start having an office is the moment you're restricting your talent to a company within the postcode of that area. And I just thought, do I really want to do that? And no, I don't really. So I took a decision. Oh, there was a fourth reason. I've got three small kids. And I just thought, time in a car, traveling to an office in a location where I'm going to get, you know, talent sort of closer to London, because that's where they tend to all hang out, means time I'm not with my kids. So I just thought, hold on a minute, it's all stacking up here. I'm not going to get an office. I'm just going to make a decision. We're going to run a remote business. And that's what we did from the word go.
Those are three really great reasons. Let's go back to recruiting talent from all over rather than being limited to your, here we call it a zip code.
Postcode.
Rather than being limited to that, what has that been able to do for your workforce?
It's just brilliant because, I mean, everything we're about is about attracting, you know, demand, you know, attracting business to us, right? So we always advocate the inbound business model, and that includes attracting talent. You know, when you're out there creating content and, you know, you're out there talking to potential customers through your content, you attract best fit customers, but the same is of talent. So people want, they've decided they want to work with you. They quite like the model. They like what you do. They're passionate about what you do. And I think in that way, you start attracting people that already fit your culture, and they may not live in where we are, right? I'm based in Portsmouth on the south coast of the UK. It's great. I'm like an 8-minute walk from the seafront. you know, the best minds from my business don't necessarily live in Portsmouth. And it just allows me to open up to access a talent pool that also don't want to sit in a car for 2 hours to get to an office, that have great experience. They have amazing experience with blue chip companies, but they want a different work style. They want work-life balance for whatever reason. They may have a family, they may not, but they appreciate the value of working at home or working remotely. And this just opens it up for me to access that talent pool, which is superb, you know, because big companies, they don't necessarily want to work like that yet. I don't think they've understood the key benefit of it. And as a result, you know, we've got people all over the UK. We've got people in Barcelona. We've got folks in the United States. And, you know, we've got some people that just love traveling. So at the minute, they're somewhere in Asia and Europe. So I don't know where they are, but my philosophy is I totally trust the people that we have. And as long as they get the work done, why would I question where they are? So, that's my philosophy.
Good philosophy to have. But the question is, how do you trust them?
Wow, that's a good one. Because when I describe this to some companies, they're just like, well, how do you know that they're getting their work done? You know, if they're in the office each day, actually, they could come in, open their laptop up. How can you still be sure they're getting their work done? You've got to start changing the way you look at business success, I think, in many ways. You've got to, and I'm challenging my HR team with this as well. It's not about, you know, you could just have people coming in, opening their laptops and being on Facebook all day. They're not still going to get any work done. So you've got to have a trust-based culture that's geared around different kinds of performance measurements, if you like. I don't like performance management. It feels a bit, you know, like you're managing people. And I don't manage people because I'm not a taskmaster. I'm not going to be looking over people's shoulders. I don't need them in the office. But at the same time, I completely trust they make the right decisions, that they'll call upon us when they need us. But we also have infrastructure internally that helps us to constantly stay in touch with each other. It's not like I don't talk to them. I do. But we have internal chat, which is quite fun. So we use that a lot as a way of staying in touch. So there's different mechanisms. It's made us really change the way we run our business because we don't see everybody every day and we don't go for coffee with them every day. We've had to, in many ways, structure in conversations, but then have a platform where we can have a lot of off-the-cuff conversations as well.
I remember, I think it was episode 2, where I talked with Pat from Bali Welch. So she's created this amazing community within the walls of her business, but she now wants to be able to allow people to work remotely. Now, the thing about her was autonomy was not the issue. She trusts her employees. She, as a matter of fact, she talked about the very thing that you said. Sometimes people are at work, she'll walk by, they're on Facebook, you know, other times they're working, and that's okay. Because what's the most important is really output versus time working, right? What you're actually bringing to the table, what you actually can put out to share. And that she finds that people's output is more when they're given autonomy. They're not hiding behind their desk, like you say, right? Because they're buying in to, they have a passion for the business and they're bought into that, right? Yeah. But now her biggest challenge again is, how do I create that same type of community outside the walls of my workforce? Yeah. And you're saying this is how you do it.
Yeah, definitely. And I think just our human way of working sort of rubs off on our customers and they appreciate that, I believe. I mean, I think they quite like our more authentic, this is us, we bring our entire selves to the job. It's not like we shut the laptop down and become somebody else at the end of work. I really encourage bringing personality into business because at the end of the day, people buy from people. And it's an interesting thought about that output and because I'm struggling with that a little bit because I think output, a measurement of output is one measure of achieving and success. But I'm also looking at outcomes. So how we measure our entire success, you know, we focus a lot on NPS scoring with our customers, satisfaction. Are we delivering above, beyond, below expectations? You know, and collectively, and this ties a lot to our name around tribes and tribal impact, because I think this is, it's a bit like a collective, it's a community, it's about collaboration, you know, there's no hierarchy, we collectively work on this thing together, therefore we have to collectively measure the performance of what we do together. And I love companies like John Lewis, you know, where they've got like a partnership model, where you're not bonused on how much revenue you bring in. I shall never do that in my company. I hope I never do it, but I've always said I'm never going to do that, because you change the behavior of people in business. And I just feel that, you know, this is a collective collective thing. This is a partnership with me and the members of the tribe, and we do this together. So we're totally changing, I guess, the way that we measure people. I haven't worked out whether it's outcomes versus outputs. I'm sure it's probably a healthy mix of both. But yeah, I like exploring stuff like that, and I haven't got the answer for that, but I'm working on it. So it's good fun. That's why I love running a business, because you just explore. It's like a big adventure. And yeah, but I think the whole remote working thing, we are getting there with that. We've got room to improve, but we have a way that we manage it. And with collaborative tools, like us, a lot of people use Slack, we use Microsoft Teams, but we've got load chatting channels on there. We even have a water cooler channel on there where people just drop stuff in, you know, if they've noticed it. Or at the minute, we're all talking about the heat, you know, we're just chatting to each other about that online. But we also have one, bring your pets corner, because, you know, if you haven't got kids in our company, most of us have got pets, so we have a little channel for sharing pet pictures because we just like that stuff. So yeah, it's kind of fun. We love all that stuff. And also, you bring yourself to work.
So I love what you just shared, Sarah, because I was going to ask you, so with all these people in different places, and you can say, well, we have a chat room, you know, and we chat, but are they being engaged to chat? Is what I was going to ask you, which you already shared. So yes, I love these ideas, because if you just say, hey, I've got a chat room, some people are going to engage and some people aren't. But if you start to create these chat rooms around things that people love and relate with each other, that's where I think that it starts to work for you. So I love that you shared that, because that's a tip somebody can take right now and begin to utilize in their workforce. And I'm guessing if somebody put these types of chats in place, even before they began working remotely, and they started building these chat rooms to where they felt comfortable, like, hey, I'm building this electronic community, then it might be easier for them to let go and begin to let these employees, you know, work remotely, because they're like, okay, I've created this community now.
You know, that's such a good point. Can, you know, I remember in a previous role that I had, when all these online communities were kicking off and everybody, oh, we need more engagement in the community. The ones that everybody seemed to set up tended to sit around the functional role. Okay, so you had a marketing community, you had a sales community, you had a training community. And I think that's where people sort of go a bit wrong. I mean, they can help and they're a great place to put stuff and to inspire conversation. But some of the most popular communities that I saw, there was one around Excel, right? And Excel tips and tricks. And it was one of the most used communities of all, you know, like also LGBT communities or social media communities. You know, they're sort of, they're not functionally led conversations. They're interest led conversations where people want to engage. People are motivated to engage. And I think that actually is where we also have another one actually called Gin Club, because I love a gin and tonic. And in brackets, it's called, also known as the parent support group, because and that one's quite popular. So this is where we share tips on, you know, how do we keep our kids occupied over the summer holiday? How do we cook dinner for kids that are fussy about their food? You know, we just share tips because quite a lot of us are parents. So that's quite a good one. Gin Club.
That's funny. I like that one a lot. I don't particularly care for gin, but I would think it was fun just because of the content, right? Like that would just be fun. And I do love the fact that you did bring that up, that when it's led by what we relate to together, and it's not like some forced thing, like, oh, we have these five chat rooms that are about this, right? And it's just picked, but instead it's something that happens naturally.
Yeah, it has to, you know, it's conversation. So that's what we, you know, we try and encourage. And it's all about bringing your human self to work and being okay with that. And that ties in a lot to this whole trust culture, because if people feel like they can't be who they are, this is where it all sort of breaks down a little bit. So I think that's key to how we run. It's okay to be outspoken, to say what you think, you know, and to have constructive conversations. And that all ties into, I think, having this healthy, happy workplace. So, you know, for me, that's key, and helping people feel confident in doing that.
Ooh, I like that. I like that, because that's a crux for everybody. People don't think they can say what they need to say at work. They're fearful of losing their jobs if they speak out. People are, right? And so creating a culture where communication is key. I love the bring yourself to work. That's a great motto. Do people really know what that means if you don't explain it to them? And I know we've talked about this in the podcast before. Do they trust their employer enough at this stage in the game? Because we don't see a lot of employers with this type of autonomy yet, right? Mm-hmm. Actually, everybody on my podcast is always this way. So there's far more than we think, which is why I do the podcast. The real question is, how do we begin to get employees to trust when we begin to make the changes in our business that create the autonomy that they're asking for?
Yeah, and how you get employees to trust you. I don't think you can get your employees to trust you. I think you just have to create that culture, which is that untouchable, very difficult thing that a lot of companies struggle to try and create. But I don't think you create it. I think you just got to live it. You've got to live what you believe in. You've got to have a true purpose, a true gut feel. And I think a lot of what tribal's culture stems from is probably my personal values. I've learned a lot having worked in many different corporations over my career. I've learned what I like and I learned what I don't like. And I've kind of built that into the company. It's like, we don't do stuffy. We don't do complex. We don't do hierarchies. We don't do, you know, I'm better than you because I've got a bigger job than you. We don't do politics. I haven't got time for that. Anyways, too much of that going on in the UK. I don't need any more of it. So I just think it has to be, you have to live it. And this actually, I understand this more because when we work with companies that want to do employee advocacy, for example, unless you've got a trust-based culture, you are going to struggle to get your employees to say nice things about you on social media. It stems from there. And one of the first things that we do is check out glassdoor.com for the companies that we're about to work with to get a real feel for what is going on. Do people trust the CEO? What is the opinion? You got to be careful with Glassdoor because a lot of people go on there just to moan, but it does give you a bit of an indicator as to what's going on in the culture. So yeah, so I think this is why I'm so passionate about it, really. I'm not saying we've got it all sewn up. We've got things that we can learn and we will still evolve. And as we grow, we're going through other cultural changes, you know, because we're growing and we need processes and things that we've never had before. So you always have to change.
Yeah. Well, you just said fun, which is one of your F words, and you have to be flexible, which is what we're talking about right now. So let's just go right into the F words. Your F words. I love that. How did you come up with the F words? And then talk about why they're so important.
Well, it's funny. I was trying to get to the crux, the gut of what tribal is about. It's very difficult when you're so close to it. But I was trying to find words that really describe what I feel about this business, trying to get to the heart of what makes tribal tribal. And I kept coming up with these words and I noticed a pattern and that they all began with F. And I didn't do that on purpose. I just thought, oh, there's a bit of a trend here. Why don't we just call them the F words? And it kind of stuck and everybody kind of remembers them now. And I just, you know, and it's nice because there's about 7 or 8 of them. And I've been on interview calls today, actually, because we're hiring as we're growing. Mm-hmm. And I don't expect people to remember all 7. For goodness sake, I can't remember all 7 and I wrote them, right? But the ones that I think call out to people is what's important to me. What are the 3 that actually resonated most with you? Because that tells me a story about the person that's about to join us. And I think that's okay. It's not a test about, do you know all 7 of them? It's about which were the 3 that most resonated with you. And, you know, even on a call today with, you know, sort of a candidate, that she picked out 3 that most resonated with her. And I just thought, oh, that's really cool. And she described why. And I think that's fine. But I reckon, you know, core to me, the F words are what speak to me. It speaks to why tribal is what it's like. It's the culture. And it's, you know, fun. If you're not having fun, why bother? And I always say, you know, let's focus on the fun. The numbers are going to come. Okay. And if we have fun building this business together, then we're going to grow together. And I quite like that feeling. Flexibility, because I value that, because I've got kids. A lot of the people that work with us have got kids. Being able to engineer your work around when you can work, I think is hugely important, because I mean, I value that. So fearless, you know, in a company our size, you haven't got time to be fearful. You just got to go right on in and have a go, learn, you've got to be quick. And feedback is key for us. Focus, you know, when you're working at home remotely, it's quite easy. I need to put the washing out. Oh, I'll just have a cup of tea. I'll have a biscuit. You've got to focus when you're a remote worker. So learning to focus is key. And actually, thinking about this, I might put some little training things around that internally about how you can focus. I think that might help us. We could share some tips. Maybe we need to set up a channel on our chatter. That's quite cool, actually. I might do that.
Ooh, so, yeah. I love it.
Yeah. So, yeah, I love my F words. And yeah, no doubt we'll switch them, change them, evolve them. I don't know. So,
well, I like them all. And really and I love the fact that you talk to the interviewees, because you're right. When they do pick them out, it gives you some type of an indication about who this person is, right?
Yes.
And definitely. I love that idea. I mean, rather than the dreaded question, what are your strengths and what are your weaknesses? You know, you could say, what out of these words stand out to you? That's such a better question of identifying someone's strengths, I think.
Yeah.
Personally, yeah. I love that idea. Okay, so let's see where we're at here. What were the other two? You gave us five, but you said there was seven.
Yeah, finance is one. I always put a little thing under them. Finance, make mindful investments. You know, don't just whittle away money on a 5-star hotel. You know, just think, is this what I would spend my money on if I was traveling somewhere? And I want people to be mindful of the investments that we make as a business. Feedback, obviously, is one. Freedom. I always think, you know, freedom, stay curious, keep innovating. You know, you have the freedom to be fearless. Go do it and make sure you have fun at the same time. So they're the ones, the additional ones that I might not have covered off.
And they all feed back to the other.
Yeah, I know. You're getting into this now.
Right, I am. I'm like, hey, wait a minute. I like this. Yeah, it's the same with Karen in our last podcast. All of her pillars feed back to each other. And yeah, I think that's super interesting, that part of it. But going back to the fearless and the feedback, those two, I love how you said you've got to come to work fearless and then you've got to, well, listen to feedback, right? So one of my biggest things is continuous improvement. I talk about it all the time, having an agile mindset, right? Like being able to go in and not be afraid to start something and then also not be afraid that it may not be going the way that you think it is. And so you get feedback and then you can go in the right direction instead of just pushing forward and not listening to things. You know what I mean? Like we get projects of mine and we just get going on them. And then the end result, we're like, oh, that didn't really work. But when you're talking about being flexible, fearless, and feedback, you're going to come in full bore and you're going to be looking at it at all times during the process.
Yeah, feedback's massively important. And I have to say, it's probably one of the things, I'm probably pretty good at positive feedback. I've got to work on like giving constructive feedback. It's one of the ones that I struggle with the most, but I do recognize that as a business, I don't have all the answers, right? And I have to listen. I listen all the time. And without feedback, we can't grow our business. We don't adjust our products, our services. I want to hear all the feedback, good and bad. But I also want to give the team feedback as well so they can grow and with our business, you know, and grow to be something bigger and better than when they first joined us. And that you can only do that if you get feedback. So that is quite a core one to us. It's the top one actually in my list.
Feedback is very important. I like what you said because it brought up this quote that I always think about is they say, if you're the smartest person in the room, then you're in the wrong room, right? Yeah. And if every leader of a business understood that, I've never understood this, even as an employee myself, is that you hire these talented people with all of these skills that you yourself really do not have. And then we micromanage those people if we had any clue what they actually really do in their, you know, in their job. Because as a manager, you may have people that do a whole bunch of different jobs and some you've never really done yourself. And then instead of saying, look, you're smarter than me at this, I'm going to listen to what you have to say and then we'll make an informed decision together. Managers like to come in and act. I don't know why it almost feels sometimes like they feel threatened by the employee if they know more. And really it needs to be, this is why I hire talented people, right? Is to bring this stuff to the table that I don't have.
Absolutely. I don't see the point in that either. And I just think maybe we're probably so far the other way. We give people the freedom to make it their own, to shape it, to seek feedback from others. It's a very integrated model where, you know, the feedback goes both ways, but we give people the freedom to find their own way, make their own mistakes, and we learn from that. That's key. Otherwise, you're not growing. It's okay to make mistakes. I always say that. It's like, I'd rather you make mistakes. I'd rather you have a go and make a mistake than keep asking me and then I have to, you know, sort of guide you through it. Just have a go. In fact, probably, and this is what happens in most cases, they do a better job of it or have better ideas than I do. So it's okay. But I think, you know, when you've been conditioned in a corporate job, for example, where you do have hierarchies and you do have performance management and you do have, you know, people managing upwards, it's quite hard to break away from that. Culturally, it's quite difficult to accept that you have freedom and that actually you're a smart person and you probably can do a really good job. But it's hard. I think a lot of people struggle. I did to start with, just to think, oh, the world is my oyster. I can just have a go. And I think a lot of people can struggle with that when they move into a company like ours, where it's like, just get on with it. Have a go. Get on with it. You've got permission. Go. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Stop asking.
they're fearful. It's like fail fast. Get in there and fail fast. Fail faster. The faster we fail, the more we're learning.
Yeah. Fearful is what you say. But, you know, we're about fearless. And
right.
That's trying to get moving people. God, I tell you what, this is the F word podcast. This is. I'm going to play this back and tick off all of the F words. I think it's brilliant.
I do. Oh my gosh. Please give me that number. Yeah, that'd be great. I'm going to put that in the show notes for sure. That is so much fun. Okay. So here we are. We're getting ready to close. And this was a great conversation, as they all are. I just can't even tell you how much I love doing this podcast. So in closing, though, is there anything that you think needed to be said that we did not get to today?
Do you know, I knew you were going to bring that up. And I thought I've just had so much fun talking about this. I would say the only thing I'd like to stress is that working in the business that we're in, everything is connected to everything else. So getting your employees to advocate your brand, it won't happen unless they love their brand and understand their place and role in the brand. You know, so that I think is connected to making sure your employees understand and are engaged in the story and getting them to be okay with that, you know, and helping them crack down this like facade of this is business Sarah and this is home Sarah. You know, the two are actually very integrated. They're very much the same person. So it's getting people to feel comfortable with being their human self in the company, giving them the platform and tools to be able to do that. Try and not be too structured about how you do that. And it's going to do more than create an engaged workforce. You're going to create a whole army of ambassadors that are happy to go out and talk about you on social media. And I think it does start with the culture and you know, this happy workforce that feel comfortable that they can do that. So yeah, so I think that's probably the one thing I'd add. You know, it's going to add so much more than just an engaged workforce. You're going to have an advocating workforce as well, and that's how you start attracting your future talent to the business. So that's all I'd add.
Beautifully said. That's a great thing to add. I love it. I hope that you'll come back and be our guest again on the show.
Oh, I'd love to. Oh, I love talking about this stuff. Yeah, I'm more than happy to. Yeah, tell me.
I'm sure that there's other things that you're doing that are amazing that we haven't even touched on. So I'd love to have you back again. But for this podcast, this episode, I want to thank you very much, Sarah, for spending your time, your afternoon here with us.
Thank you, Kimberly. Thanks very much for having me. I really enjoyed it.
Yeah, I really enjoyed it as well. We'll look forward to your next episode. In the meantime, this is the closing of the Happy Healthy Workplace podcast. Today is complete. Check the links for Sarah Goodall and Tribal Impact, along with the show notes on the website, The Happy Healthy Workplace, and have a happy, healthy day.
That's a wrap for today. The Happy Healthy Workplace podcast is now complete. Be sure to subscribe and join us weekly for secrets, solutions, or strategies that help you create a profitable business where people really